Hey friend, welcome to the Self-Care Isn't Selfish podcast. I'm your host, Emily Nichols. As a Whole30 certified coach, wife, busy working boy mom, and your self-care guru, I'm here to help you start putting yourself first without the guilt. Each week you'll hear motivating and practical tips on how you can create a habit of self-care through interviews with my amazing guests or quick solo episodes with me. After each episode, you'll walk away with an action plan and feel empowered to implement what you have learned into your life. So grab a cup of coffee, glass of wine, or your favorite sparkling water, and let's do this. Hey gang, welcome back to the Self-Care Isn't Selfish podcast. You're listening to episode 9 with my amazing guest, Ashley Homol. Before we get into our conversation, I just wanted to congratulate my Whole30 group. We just finished 30 days of no legumes, no sugar, dairy, gluten, no alcohol, and no scale for 30 days. And the non-scale victories and what they are learning through their reintroduction is just amazing. So if you finished a Whole30 this past month as well, kudos to you. I hope you take what you learned into your food freedom like my clients are. And if you ever want to get a chance to work with me and my Whole30 coaching services, just visit my website at emily-nichols.com. Ladies, lifting heavy weights is not going to make you look like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I promise. So Ashley and I are going to debunk that myth today, and I can't wait for you to hear our conversation and her story about overcoming obstacles and using lifting heavy weights to build her confidence, not only physically, but mentally as well. And I think this is really something you can put into your self-care as far as doing something physically that you didn't think you could do to give you the confidence that you can apply to any areas of your life. So let me tell you a little bit about my guest, Ashley Homol. She really has a servant's heart. She's been a hairstylist for over 12 years, and you know, a hairstylist is almost like a built-in therapist as well. But she's also a fitness coach at Iron Valley Barbell here in Indianapolis with her husband, Zach, and you can catch her staying pretty busy with that and her 8-year-old son, Crew, and their 2 doggies. What's really cool is she also has some amazing ebooks to help you build and sculpt your body to help you feel confident from the inside out. I'll make sure to include a link in the show notes so you can check out some of those ebooks. We'll also be getting into a conversation about her event coming up called Armor Up. It's going to be a bullying workshop for teenage girls and talking about, you know, having your armor on to battle bullies or, you know, fighting even your own self-limiting beliefs, which I think is so amazing to start with girls at a young age to armor up and feel strong so they're ready to win the war. So sit back and relax. Enjoy this great conversation with Ashley Homol, and I hope you leave this episode feeling strong. Okay, gang, I am so excited to have Ashley on the show today. So Ashley, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me. I'm so pumped to be here. I absolutely just admire you. I just think what you're doing is so cool, and it's an honor to be on. So thank you.
Oh, thank you. Right back at you. So, well, okay, I start every show asking my guests, what does self-care mean to you? So Ashley, what does self-care mean to you?
Self-care to me means saying no more, and that's just my own issue. So to me, self-care is saying no to the things that take me away from taking care of myself, which is, hey, can you do this? Can you do that? And I'm a yes man at heart. I'm a people pleaser, something I've grown to kind of try to come out of. But self-care to me is learning boundaries within every relationship I have, whether it's my, you know, a coworker or my relationship with my parents, whatever it is. I'm just learning to say no more so I can focus on what I need to be whole for everybody else.
Yeah, that's so good. I don't think people realize no can be a complete sentence. Just no, thank you.
Oh man. And it sometimes feels like people look at you like, I can't say that.
Yeah.
Because our culture has just made us feel like if we don't go along with the crowd, then, you know, it's like, now you're just being rude, or, you know, she's not a very nice person, when really it's you know, saving that energy source for other things.
Yeah, I had made a post about saying no a couple weeks ago on social media, just saying, hey, no, thank you, and a smile can go a long way. And somebody commented on there, they're like, but don't you feel like you need to give the reason why? And I'm like, no.
Man, that right there, just to see one person comment on that just shows that, like, we struggle with that, mm-hmm. you know, and it really is, like, by me saying no to somebody, it can be amazing how it instantly almost makes the person feel, like, offended. And to me, that just shows that they don't have healthy boundaries within their life, because, you know, for me to say no, it only requires me to have great relationships with my husband, with my kid, you know, with just the people that I really need to pour into.
Yep.
And so when they take offense to it, I have learned that it has nothing to do with me and everything to do with just boundaries they haven't created in their own life, you know?
Exactly. So. Oh my gosh. I could talk about this for a whole hour. So, but
next podcast.
Yeah. Next show. So let's talk about you a little bit more. Tell everyone a little bit about yourself. What's your story?
So just kind of the sped up version, got married back in June to my husband, Zach Homol, who is the owner of Iron Valley Barbell. We're a strength training gym right out in the Indianapolis area, off Traders Point area. I'm a hairstylist. I've been in the hair industry for 15 years. So I've been in the service industry over half my life, which has really molded me into a lot of client relation type things that I do now, because now I am an ebook author and my fitness coach. You know, I'm really trying to also create a movement to the crisis that's going on within our teens with bullying. So a little bit about myself is I have a passion for broken people. I was a broken person at one point, and I still am, but I mean, I was divorced. I've been through the ringer. I didn't have a home. You know, I'd gotten arrested at some point in my life, and, you know, I just really knew what it felt like to feel just the complete lowest of low. And if I was able to come out of that, I just want to help people come out of their, you know, their brokenness. And so I would say just, I'm somebody after, you know, bringing out the best in people. That's a huge passion of mine, because once I found it inside me, it's just something that I know that everybody's capable of having. Yeah. So.
Absolutely. Well, I think we're all broken in our own ways. And it's really interesting. Every career path you've been on, it's been in some type of service industry, mm-hmm. whether it would be with fitness or being a hairstylist. And that can be an emotional job, because people will come in and just pour their hearts out to you in either way.
Oh, for sure, girl. Yeah, that's definitely, you know, and people, you know, ask me like how I'm able to handle the mental and emotional, you know, because it is true. One minute I'll have a girl come in and say, oh my gosh, you know, my son just, you know, got straight A's. And then the next girl that comes in, she's like, my mom has cancer, you know, and really maneuvering through all of those interactions with people while providing a high quality service, while also trying to be emotionally available, professional. You know, it's definitely a challenge, but it's just been so cool. The connection it's made, that I feel like I've taken my career as not just a job, but as a purpose, you know, and I've tried to figure out ways to perfect my craft, but to actually spend the time utilizing it to, you know, help people just internally and showing them that, you know, beauty comes from within, not just an outward appearance, but it's amazing how those little physical changes can help trigger that inside us all. So that's something that I feel like the service industry has provided for me. Yeah. Now, did I come to that realization, you know, like 5-10 years ago? No, I couldn't wait to wrap up my next client and move on and go home and binge, you know, Netflix. But, you know, as I've grown to realize, so that's kind of a little about my son. He keeps me extremely busy. I mean, he's 8. He has a really miraculous story in himself. You know, he had open heart surgery when he was right before his second birthday. So he's a little warrior, and I know you and I share, you know, that passion of just, you know, our kiddos being such strong little guys.
Yep.
So that's just kind of, you know, a little bit about me and just kind of, where my career has led me and what path I'm on right now.
Yeah. What I really love about you is you are strong, not just physically, but emotionally. That's the vibe I get from you just following you on social media and everything. And I think it's really inspiring for women to see a strong woman.
Thank you.
Can you share a little bit about your journey to the gym and lifting heavy stuff?
Oh, for sure. This is what gets me so amped is talking about this. I feel like we live in a highlight reel society. So we live on Instagram seeing how everyone's life is better than ours. Mm-hmm. And I got caught up in that. There was a stage in my life where, like I had told you, within less than a year, my son had open heart surgery. I got a divorce and I was arrested. So those three things were basically feeling as if they defined of who I was, that I was just, you know, worthless, that I, you know, wasn't a good mom, that I, you know, would never find anybody, you know, I failed at this, I failed at that, you know, and I was running away from my life, and it caused me to make really poor choices because I was finding outlets and things that weren't healthy. Just to run away from the demons inside of me that I really needed to expose. I finally felt like I had to show up. You know, once I hit my most rock bottom, I knew that I had to show up and to be the kind of mom I needed to be. Maybe me, this was the way I looked at it. Maybe me as an individual wouldn't succeed, but I knew my son had to. And maybe me as a person wouldn't, but my parents deserved to have their daughter back. And that's what kind of fueled me to just start going to the gym. And what ended up happening was I started off with boxing, and it was so funny, Emily, because I was literally like the girl that signed up for a year membership at this place where it wasn't just like boxing. Like, it was like I was training with 13-year-old wrestling boys, like where you bowed to the mat, you wrapped your hands, you know, all that stuff. Like, it was intense. So it was really cool because I learned really awesome self-defense and, but man, just punching a punching bag and, you know, really getting into that training style was really intense, but I couldn't really afford to continue doing that. Just being a single mom. So I started just weightlifting, and it was amazing to watch like the things I didn't think I could do in the gym. And once I would do them, I'm like, okay, Ashley, like no one else has done that for you. So if you were able to lift this, like, why can't you remove this out of your life? You know, this emotional barrier, this, you know, negative self-talk, because you're overcoming these things and you're becoming more powerful and more strong physically. So it just couldn't not affect me emotionally and mentally. So I became drawn to the gym and what it did for me, not just physically, but I mean, I would sometimes just go to the gym, just cry. I don't even know why I was crying, but I obviously just needed to cry that day. And then I'd be like, okay, I'm done for the day. But it just became my therapy, and it was a healthy outlet. You know, it wasn't a destructive one. And what I found out quickly was not only did it give me this boost of self-confidence, but I was like, oh my gosh, like look at my body. Like, you know, I'm like getting the nice shape side effect. That, right. Like everyone says weightlifting will make you bulky and weightlifting will do this and all this stuff. When really lifting heavy has allowed me to get out my like aggression and just things that just frustrate me. You know, things I can't control, things that I need to learn to let go of, but it's also helped mold me into like a physically strong woman. And it's really given me this physical shape that I never thought was possible with weightlifting, because our society doesn't tell us that as women.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's such a metaphor for going to the gym, either lifting heavy things, because it's like you have this sense of accomplishment and you're like, I can do hard things. Like you said, you thought you could never do this or that or lift this heavy or do that. And just to see how far you've come, that's such a great metaphor and confidence booster in other areas of your life.
Definitely. Definitely. And you know, it's so easy to fall into other things that numb the actual issue. Yeah. You know, and it's the same with, you know, working out. There's so many fad diets, fit tees, and, you know, 5-minute abs, you know, all these loopholes that people fall for. But really, we all know that long-term gain is just where true happiness and true success is. You know, when you put the work in, not just physically, but, you know, mentally and emotionally, like that's where that joy comes from. That's where that success and that drive comes from. And I'm set, like, so I was telling you, like, I know what it's like to be low. It's not like I've just always been a fitness girl or I've always, you know, been able to lift weights. You know, it really came from, with purpose, you know?
Yeah. I feel like a lot of people in the fitness realm, we all have some type of story of where we came from and where we're at now. And that's why we want to help other people. 'Cause it's like, why wouldn't you want other people to feel this is amazing and help transform their lives too.
Man, amen, girl. That's so, so true. Like, it's just, I love that we're in this season where it's all about women supporting women and empowering and not competing. Mm. Now, granted, there's a lot of that still out there. I don't know if that'll ever go away, but I've found sisterhood in weightlifting and in fitness because I know what it takes to do it. Yeah. You know, I don't want to get up at 5 a.m. and work out. I don't. I rarely want to actually work out, if I'm being honest.
Yeah.
But it's just like I can't go off of feelings and I can't go off of like I'm not motivated today. It's a non-negotiable because I need it in my life. And it's just set the tone for the people in my life and, you know, my friendships and my parenting and everything that they see self-care through the way I'm doing it. And I'm hoping that it will just rub off, you know?
Yeah. So you train with a lot of female clients at your gym, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what would you say to someone? I know you already mentioned this, you know, a lot of women have the wrong impression of weightlifting that they're going to get bulky.
Yeah.
So what would you say to someone listening that's like, okay, I've always wanted to try to get into weightlifting, but I'm not sure where to start, or they feel maybe a little intimidated to start.
For sure. You know, or like I would add to that, or maybe someone has tried it and had the bad experience from it. I would definitely say if you're interested in starting, I feel like there would be so many fitness coaches that would offer up a consultation, a complimentary consultation, just to go over things and to discuss what the goal is, and breaking down those barriers that are keeping people from exploring this avenue. So I can say that I have weightlifted before in the past, and the only results I got were thick quads, you know, like I felt like I was just like bulking in areas I didn't want to. And now that I've been through training and education of understanding proper lifting of weights, not saying that everybody, you know, trains the same. Sure. It's been incredible to see when it's actually done correctly and the form is focused on more, the results are out of this world. It kind of disappoints me when I see a lot of people just maybe in group weightlifting classes or, and not that those are bad. I think those are great. And I don't want this to be like, I'm talking crap about that.
Right,
but
right.
What I hate is when I hear women then give up and they're like, oh no, weightlifting only does it. But it's just like, did you ever work with someone one-on-one that as you were doing those squats, they were showing you how to activate your glutes and not your quads? Did they show you as you were learning how to do a clean to, you know, not jerk the weight, but stabilize yourself, you know, things like that, that is, you know, can be set women off. But what I have noticed is like, I have this one girl, I'm about to show her progress. It's unbelievable. 2 months, the amount of weight loss that she's had from weightlifting only, and just the amount of though, like, it's not just weight loss. She's getting tighter too, you know? And so not only are you burning calories, but you're developing muscle tone, and that's sexy and it's empowering. And then I really feel like when I'm out, I mean, maybe I couldn't, but I really feel like if someone were to mess with Crew and I, like I'd know how to respond.
Right.
Like I would feel strong enough to be able to be like, man, I freaking deadlift 200 pounds. I'll deadlift you. You know what I mean?
Like, come at me, bro.
Exactly. And I know that might sound like super meathead-ish, but you know, there's something empowering as a female to have that like horrible idea of that weightlifting only bulks you.
Yeah.
If you feel that you're doing that, you need to be maybe having a second opinion.
Yeah.
And I think that that's even true with doctors and a lot of things that choose, you know, going off of one opinion or one circumstance, if we only define that by one experience, you know, that can just really limit us from something that could potentially be one of the greatest joys of our life.
How's that saying go? Oh yeah, all things are possible with coffee and mascara. Well, that's certainly true for me, and I love to have my coffee every morning after my workout, and I don't really leave the house without mascara. So my fellow blondies, I know you feel me on this. But gang, check it out. Having my coffee every morning is part of my self-care routine, and I always take my coffee blended with Nutpods and coconut oil. So Nutpods is a dairy-free creamer. It's made from a blend of almond butter and coconut cream. I love the French vanilla flavor. It's my favorite. It's super yummy, super smooth, but even better, it's Whole 30 approved. So gang, head on over to nutpods.com and use the code EmilyNichols22 to get 15% off your first order of Nutpods. That's EmilyNichols22, EmilyNichols22. And let me know once you receive your Nutpods what your favorite flavor is and how you take your coffee. So remember, just head on over to nutpods.com. Awesome. Well, I think so much when, you know, going back to what you were talking about with lifting heavy, it just builds so much confidence. And I love what you're doing with an event you're hosting this month. You're calling it the Armor Up Bullying Workshop. So tell me all about this, because I think this is so unique and so needed.
So cool. Yeah. Thank you for those compliments. So yeah, I really can't explain like where it came from, but I was talking to my husband the other day about how I really feel that I need to be making more of a difference, and how can I do that? And I think that the thing that stands out to me the most is the Bible verse that shares, you know, if you're not going to give joyfully, don't give at all. And so sometimes we get caught up in what we should be doing, you know, the things we should serve, we should be in a small group, we should go to the food bank, you know, but I just didn't have a passion for, so I would watch myself doing all these things, but just not really feeling it. Yeah. So, you know, he was challenging me, why don't you think of a time where, you know, you really could feel that people could use a strength of yours. So in high school, I was bullied, my junior year, it was my sophomore year into my junior year is when it got really, really bad. But, you know, and it really defined who I became, because I totally ran away from myself, because all that I gathered from that time was, if I wasn't this person, I wouldn't be being attacked. So it immediately led me into shame, into abandoning myself, into trying to become like anybody else who I thought was better version. And it made me make just poor choices. You know, I ended up in a marriage that, you know, wasn't necessarily the right one. It gave me the greatest gift I've ever received, which is my son. But I just really ran from myself and tried to become somebody I wasn't. So it truly started at the root of being bullied. I'm also seeing this huge epidemic of just teenage suicide and mental health issues and, you know, all these school shootings, and just, and my heart just breaks because we can't solve it all, you know? And so my whole thought was, if I could have had somebody during that time help me to feel like I wasn't alone, help me to understand that what's being said about me isn't me, and help to empower me and give me tools to use to overcome it, I don't know that I would have spiraled down, such a hole of abandoning myself and being shamed full of who I was. And I feel like those types of feelings allow us to almost then self-bully ourselves into a really dark place. Mm. And so my whole backing with that was basically, I'm just on fire to help not only just the victims of it, but even the people who are doing it, because we all know that that's coming from a place of hurt, of lacking, of something in their life that they're then using to, you know, pick on somebody to just like, you know, make them feel better, like that instant gratification.
Yeah.
So with this Armor Up, the idea of it is, you know, you would never enter into a battle and then put your armor on. You make sure that before this battle hits you, your armor is already on. That's just a classic representation of, you know, war in itself. So, you know, maybe some of these girls aren't being bullied, or maybe the issue hasn't gotten that bad, but if they are prepared for something that they might go through, or a friend might go through, or something that they already have the tools to clothe themselves in, to be strong enough to, you know that that's not about them. Mm-hmm. And then also giving them that healthy escape of lifting weights, for me, you know, was my healthy escape. So rather than turning to a relationship to fix you or turning to a substance to numb you.
Yeah.
What's an outlet that you can do to just release what all the crap that's going on, and showing these girls like how badass it feels to lift weights and to just, you know, do these battle ropes and medicine ball slams and all these different things, with music blaring, of course, to just really like make you feel just, you know, empowered. So that's kind of what this workshop is. I'm going to be using the first half of it talking about shame, solely because everyone's bullied differently. Maybe it's a parent is isolating their kid. Maybe someone is, you know, jealous of them. Maybe they're the bully themselves, but basically the root of everything comes down to shame, and, you know, the shame that basically tells us we are a bad person. Like, we deserve this, you know, and breaking down what that is to get to a healthier mindset for these girls. And I feel like I'm at that age where, you know, I'm still kind of like hip, you know, I'm still kind of like can remember. And, you know, I'm training girls who are like in their, you know, young 20-year-old girls and high school athletes and stuff. So I feel a connection to being able to relate to younger people. And I just, I've said this before my post, like, I don't find this to be something I'm necessarily excited about. I find this to be something I am passionately feeling that it is necessary. Like, it is necessary to do. Because excited's the wrong word, because it's really sad, actually. But I find that, like, within our youth today, that a lot of times they don't feel they can talk to their parents, and they don't feel that they can talk to someone within, you know, their family. And so to have them go someplace that is only going to empower them, make them stronger, and be around somebody who knows what it's like, as well as being within a group of girls who are experiencing similar feelings. Maybe the situation's different, but the center of defining yourself is like, I hate myself. I don't like who I am. You know, that kind of all becomes the root of it all.
You're going to build these girls up so much. That's just so, okay. So I'm 38 and I'm thinking back to when I was like middle school age, high school age, and, you know, all girls kind of go through, I think, kind of the comparison trap, or, you know, they bully. But thinking of what girls go through today with social media, I mean, I was talking to a colleague the other day, and she had said there were kids making like these ghost Instagram accounts dedicated to like making fun of like a girl.
Yeah.
I'm like, who does that? I mean, it's just a whole new set of issues. And like you said, teen suicide is on the rise. And these kids are stressed out. They have so much pressure coming from school, parents, sports. They're trying to do all the things and be successful and comparing themselves to others, that they need to be able to find some healthy outlet, like you said, like lifting weights and feeling strong and confident so they can handle all of the hard stuff in their life, because their life will never get any easier. Life is hard. There's always going to be challenges coming their way, but giving them tools and armoring them up before that happens, they'll win the war versus succumbing to it, for sure.
Yeah. And that's, you know, I think that we all have a similar outlook on that. You know, how do we can't fix bullying, you know, we can't make it go away. It's happening to me as an adult. I can't tell you how many girls will just, you know, DM me something just like, you know, you think you are all that, like just stupid stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's just been something that like I've had to practice this whole armoring up, you know, for a while, especially now that I'm getting a voice to speak on it more. Because I know that it's only going to get worse for me. And so I really feel like we can all relate to that feeling of, you know, at some point in our life, feeling attacked or feeling, you know, less than by somebody. And so whether we made that comparison ourselves or somebody imposed it on us, you know, it's teaching that mindset, you know, of like what you were saying. So I really do hope this becomes something, you know, I'm already learning. I'm already dreaming about the next one and how I'm going to make it even better and what I'm going to do that time. And I'm already dreaming about the one after that. Yeah. And I've actually had some parents tell me, like, could we do one for parents, like to help girls through that? Because if we're being honest, we are like the first generation of parents that are raising children in a social media, like social media has taken over. Yeah. Social media is even Venmo, even our finances, you're communicating. Yes. Like, you know, it's like a social media like type thing. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, all these parents aren't really sure of how they are to be conducting themselves. And do we put rules and limitations on, you know, all those different things. And it is, it's gotten so out of hand that, like you were saying, these kids are creating accounts just to pick on other people and not get blamed for it. They're finding ways, they're already smarter to figure out ways to still make it happen, but not have their name on it.
Yeah.
And so, you know, not saying that I know it all, but I think that it's so cool to see just parents like being like, I want to learn about this. Like, I want to learn how I can be better in these situations and how I can help, you know, them through this and all that stuff. So, I'm really hoping that if anything, it just brings awareness to the topic and it sets off people to be like, oh, this inspires me to want to do something as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
oh my gosh. So tell us when it is. So it's geared towards middle school and high school girls, right?
Yeah. I went ahead and just decided that for this go round, you know, middle school to high school, I didn't really keep the ages. Like I didn't really say ages, but, as of now I've got 11 signups, a majority of girls around 15 to 17, and then a handful of girls are around 11. And so I've already got two other girls that are helping me coordinate through this. So they're, you know, we're going off in groups and stuff. Okay. And the way that I am structuring it, just so a lot of people can understand it, is the first part is I have a surprise guest who has gone through the judgment of this world. And I think they're really going to enjoy who the surprised guest is and basically kind of have a nice little icebreaker with that. And basically allow them to see that it doesn't matter what your background is, you know, what your cultural differences is, you know, it's not about the actual, you know, what you're being bullied on. It's about the what is then rooted at the bottom of that, that connects us all to all of those different feelings. And so, kind of swinging that full circle, I'm hoping to get the girls to engage by anonymously writing down some things that have been said about them that they've said to people or that's happened to them. And then me and my girls are going to share those out loud, and whether they want to speak on it, it's fine. If not, then that's when me and my girls are going to share our stories of when we were their age and in hopes that it will trigger something. And then we're going to wrap it up with doing some, you know, really, I've hired a DJ to professionally create a playlist geared towards like empowerment and just, you know, freaking awesome. Like let's get it done, like kind of music.
Yeah.
And I've got a circuit set up that just, we're just going to go right into it because sometimes, you know, when we have a hard thing, we don't want people to give us advice. We just want people to listen. And then just to have a fun, you know, to have fun and to just like, you know, be together. And so wrapping it up with just, you know, encouraging that and then giving them all a gift at the end of just extending them to come back for a session with me outside. So yeah, that's kind of the structure of how it will be going down.
That's awesome. Okay.
Yeah. And it's October 13th. Sorry. October 13th, which is a Sunday, which I'm recognizing is fall break for a lot of people. But it's just kind of when it could happen, you know, from 2 to 4, it's a 2-hour event. It's $20 a girl, or I'm sorry, $25 a girl. Or if they bring a friend, it's 20 a piece for the girl. My website is my name, Ashley Homol Fitness at Gmail, or I'm sorry, .com, AshleyHomolFitness.com. I'm used to, that's my email too. Sorry guys. You can email me as well. But you can purchase those tickets on my website.
Awesome. And so, I'll make sure to include links in the show notes so people can go directly to the website and get tickets as well. And it will be at the gym, right?
Oh yeah. Sorry. It's at our gym, Iron Valley Barbell. So it's right off 465 and 86th Street, that Traders Point area where the Dick's Sporting Good is, kind of by Park 100.
Got it.
In that area, but Google Maps takes you right to it. So
got it. I can already tell you're going to have a lot of momentum with this and a lot more future workshops to come. And I love that you're focusing on the parents too, and that there's parents that want to be able to be open to talking to their kids as well. Cause you know, everyone needs someone to talk to, whether it be their parents or someone like you or a teacher or whomever, just having all these people in their corner is really, really important. So
definitely. And you know, I was bullied. My parents didn't know what to do. And, you know, it was, I, now I can look through the lens of like, gosh, I felt so bad from that, you know, what they had to go through. But, you know, my mom did everything she could to try to help, but it only kind of made things worse because, you know, she would go to the school and all that stuff and then they'd find out. And, you know, and so it just was like, I know that as a parent, what it has to feel like to be so lost. And yeah. I've now gathered ideas and things that more than likely could have been a better approach. Not that she would have or should have known at all. So I do not blame that. But I'm using that source of pain to figure out how to help, you know, what I could have used and, you know, showing parents like different things that might not be a conversation that they need to have, but it just needs to be like, you know, like, let's go do something, you know, or, you know, how to listen to your kid and not just, you know, tell them what you think or make these harsh decisions for them, but just be there. And I think if the parents can get together and just like feel that they have a community supporting them, that they have, you know, resources to like, they can then talk about it and what they're going through as their kid's going through it. Yeah. I just think that will just help the child and just the awareness as well.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, just thinking of my parents, like if I was to be extremely bullied or something in high school or somebody was bothering me, they're solution based. Like you said, they were like, oh, well, we'll just go to the school counselor and they'll just sort it out. And you're kind of like, okay, this is making my life worse because now it's going right. to get worse or now I'm embarrassed. Whereas I feel like now parents like you and I now, there's so many more resources out there and it's the stigma is going away when it comes to mental wellness for our children. And, you know,
thank God.
I mean, but there's more, we're solution based, but we're also thinking, okay, what can I do to help my child? What can I do just to listen? Because sometimes all they want you to do is just listen.
And man, that's sometimes the hardest thing as a parent to do.
Yeah.
Because there are babies.
Yeah.
I know.
Oh my gosh. All right. Well, Ashley, I'm going to wrap this up, but where, I know you mentioned your website, but where can everyone else connect with you online? Where's the best place to find you at?
So I'm on Facebook, Ashley Homol. So it's Homol. And then I'm also on Instagram, Ashley Homol, and then on Twitter, Ashley Homol. So those are my platforms. I do have a podcast. I was just talking to her about this. Mm-hmm. It's Be the 1%. And I have multiple episodes, although I'm kind of revamping my podcast to make it more just like the Ashley Homol show, more of an interview type. So look for that in the future. Definitely.
Awesome.
So, and you will be a guest and I can't wait for that day.
Ashley, you are doing some really, really cool stuff in the world. And I so appreciate you coming on the show today. And
thank you for having me.
Awesome.
Gosh, thank you for having me. I just appreciate all you're doing. So thank
my
you.
Pleasure. Didn't you love that conversation? Oh my goodness. I think there's so much power in sharing your story and sharing where you've been and the journey you went on to get to where you are today. So thank you, Ashley, for sharing your story with us. And I know I left feeling empowered after our conversation. So thank you for that. But gang, as you know, at the end of every episode, I share my three biggest takeaways so you can take action today on this area of self-care, which we're focused on being strong, not just physically, but strong from the inside out. So my first takeaway is, you know, when Ashley first started on her journey at the gym, she mentioned she went to become better for her son and for her parents. And I think a lot of times when we start doing something, we're like, I'm doing it this for my family. I'm doing this for them, which I think is a great motivator. But honestly, I think you need to put yourself first. And through that journey, I could tell with talking with Ashley, it turned into her form of self-care and her form of putting herself first so she could be there for her parents. So, you know, double check yourself on your motivation for doing anything. It's great to have motivation from your family, but ultimately you have to be doing something for yourself. And guess what? That is not selfish. So number two, my biggest takeaway, I know we said this a lot, but lifting heavy made her feel confident and strong. You know, is there anything that you've ever wanted to try and you felt like there's no way I could do that. So, my husband and I do Spartan races together. He's really great. He's competitive, gets medals. I just go out there and I ask for help because I'm short and I need help being boosted over walls and stuff. But I think there's power in doing hard things, like lifting heavy things or doing something like a Spartan race. A couple years ago, we were out in West Virginia for the first time and we were doing a beast, which was like 13 plus miles. But a few weeks before the race, I had sprained my ankle on a trail run and I just wore a brace on my ankle. And I think it took me 20,000 hours to finish that thing. I mean, when you're at the start line, you have to jump over this wall. And as soon as I came down on it, I was like, oh my gosh, it hurts. So, I stumbled my way through that race, but I felt super accomplished and proud of myself. And that just relayed to other parts of my life where I'm like, I can do hard things and I can handle, leaving a job. I can handle stress or anxiety this week because I know I can handle hard things. And lastly, going in line with her Armor Up event she has coming up, not only can this apply to young girls, but also women. You are priming yourself for when bad things happen, because ultimately, your life isn't always going to be sunshine, rainbows, and unicorns. It's not. You go through different seasons of your life. Life is like a roller coaster, and it's all in the way that you handle things. You are armored up and ready to know that you can handle whatever comes your way because you are confident. You have, faith in your back pocket. You have strength in your back pocket. So hard things are ultimately going to happen in your life, but if you armor up and anticipate if a bad thing happens, you will have positivity to get through it. I think it's going to help you out a lot in the long run. So remember, don't forget to check the links in my profile so you can follow Ashley. And also, if you have a young teenage girl here in the Indianapolis area that you think would benefit from her Armor Up Bullying Workshop, you can grab tickets in the link in my profile as well. So thanks again for listening to the Self Care Isn't Selfish podcast. Make sure to give me a follow on Instagram over at Emily Nichols 22 or at Self Care Isn't Selfish podcast, just to see behind the scene things that we're doing. And I would love, love, love it if you would leave me a few, maybe 5 stars on iTunes and, write out a review. I think so many times, someone pointed this out on another podcast, everyone's so quick to leave negative reviews. Like if you go to a restaurant and have bad service, people are so quick to be like, oh my gosh, that restaurant was so horrible. But when you're listening or going to something that's really great, people aren't quick to leave a good review. So if you are enjoying the podcast, please go to iTunes and write out a review. It means so much to me and it makes it easier for people to find this podcast. So I hope you are feeling strong and empowered and able to handle hard things coming your way. And I wanted to thank you again for listening and I'll see you next week. But in the meantime, remember, self-care isn't selfish.